Spark Books here. Today, I'm going to explain the book, People Skills, by Robert Bolton. Take care, enjoy the book, and have a nice day. People Skills 1979 is a guidebook to learning effective communication skills. It illuminates the conversational roadblocks that impede good communication and damage relationships and offers alternative methods for listening, asserting, and handling conflict. Key idea number one, fix bad conversational habits first. Most of us learn to be superficial, hide our emotions, and manipulate others from a young age. These habits are learned from well-meaning persons with poor communication tools. They can be unlearned and replaced once identified. Think about a time you tried to have a good conversation but ended up disappointed. You may have promised to treat your parents well before a holiday visit. However, when they criticized you, you argued for an hour. This is common. Most people want to communicate better. However, 12 basic communication obstacles ruin 90% of interactions. These make individuals more submissive or contentious, lower everyone's self-esteem, and impede the problem's self-determination. Sharers. Three major barrier categories exist. Judging, when you criticize, name call, or diagnose someone, you judge. Praising includes judging. Praise can dominate, manipulate, outmaneuver, or sweet talk. Sending solutions is second. You can send solutions in several ways. One is ordering, questioning the other's judgment. Threatening underlines the consequences of not implementing your proposal. When used, both lower self-esteem. Excessive or improper questioning is another approach to send solutions. Advising, which may seem harmless, insults the other person's intelligence. Although it's tempting to provide advice, only the person sharing their concern can fully appreciate its emotional and logistical scope, no matter how much they describe. Helping someone solve a problem is the goal. Avoiding concerns is the third big hurdle. When you change the subject, use reasoning, or reassure, you accomplish this. Reassurance, the last one, may surprise you, yet it can be a technique to emotionally withdraw while appearing helpful. Key idea number two, actively engaging with the speaker, is listening. Did you know you spend most of your time listening? A survey found that people with diverse jobs communicated 70% of the time. 45% was listening. Society doesn't value listening. Don't listen to them is a common childhood instruction. Inattentiveness and roadblock-laden problem-solving are traits parents learned from their parents. Most schools teach kids to listen more than any other communication ability, even though researchers believe people can only listen well 1/3 to 2/3 of the time. Thus, people tune out, ignore, misunderstand, or forget what they've heard, and most sadly, they don't listen for deeper meaning. The author suggests focusing on small clusters of skills and mastering them one at a time to improve after a lifetime of anti-listening training. Attending, following, and reflecting. Attending shows you value what the speaker is saying and are devoted to understanding them. Practice attending by facing the speaker and leaning forward in a relaxed but alert stance. Avoid defensiveness by keeping your arms and legs on cross and keeping a 3-foot gap. Eye contact is crucial. Wandering eyes show apathy. The second cluster is about not interfering with the speaker to get their perspective. This includes noticing nonverbal indicators that indicate they have something on their mind and giving non-cursive invitations to talk or door openers. A door opener may mirror the other's behavior. Attending a door opener may also include eye contact and a stance of participation. If a friend is sighing and looking down, respond, "You seem disappointed today. Can we discuss it?" If they don't, let it go. Empathetic listeners respect privacy and separateness. If they accept, give them limited encouragement to explore themselves. "Tell me more. I see, and really." Are neutral responses. Avoid closed queries that require a short answer. Instead, ask what's on your mind. These let others speak. Key idea number three, reflective listening shows empathy. Imagine a bad day. The car won't start, you're late for a crucial meeting, and coffee spills on your white shirt. After returning home, you burnt the lasagna. Your partner asks, "When will you learn to cook?" Feelings. Instead of criticizing your cooking, your partner responds, "Wow, you've had a tough day. First the car, then the meeting. Now the lasagna. How would you feel?" appreciate the impartiality, validated because they accurately summarized your experience. This is reflective listening. Reflective listening involves paraphrasing, reflecting sentiments, reflecting meaning, and summarizing. The listener paraphrases the speaker's message. Paraphrases are brief, clear, and emphasize the speaker's point. I don't know if I should have children, Maria tells her friend Sarah. I can't picture saving for a down payment while Paul and I still have college loans. What if I can't become pregnant before we buy a house? It's unjust that our parents didn't have debt. Sarah may rephrase Maria's situation by saying, you want to be financially solid before you have children, but our generation has the odds stacked against us. Instead, the listener expresses the speaker's emotions. While the speaker expresses many emotions, the listener tries to identify the main one. This helps the speaker discover their true sentiments about the problem and find a solution. Maria seemed worried and frustrated, so Sarah might add that. The listener reflects meaning by combining the speaker's feelings and facts into a brief response. Sarah might reflect meaning by saying, you're anxious about not being as financially established as you'd like before having children, and you're unhappy that our generation has the odds stacked against us. Finally, a summative reflection summarizes the conversation's important points. The listener connects the conversation's key points, helping the speaker see himself more clearly. Key idea number 4. Send three-part assertions for healthy confrontation. Listening well is crucial, but not everything. Listening and asserting maintain healthy connections. When someone invades your space, you can confront them. Setting limits is not manipulative or domineering. Asserting is when you express your needs, feelings, and desires. Assertion includes defending your own space and positively benefiting society. Everyone has a personal space, physical, psychological, and values base to defend. They need to change the world psychologically. This is the nurturing, non-aggressive way individuals connect and love. Assertion can also be placed between submission and aggression. Submissive people avoid conflict, while aggressive people take what they desire at the expense of others. Submission and aggressiveness hinder intimate partnerships. Repressed feelings can cause melancholy, anxiety, low self-esteem, migraines, chronic fatigue, hypertension, and anger against those the submissive person sacrificed for. Aggression breeds distrust and adversaries. Better, assertion. Assertion helps people take charge of their lives and start using dysfunctional behavior to meet their wants. Assertion helps people understand and accommodate one another's needs, fostering intimacy and fulfilling relationships. Assertive persons are self-confident. Send three-part assertion texts to practice assertiveness. This type of message should begin with an objective, detailed, non-judgmental explanation of the behavior you want to modify. Instead of when you don't pull your weight around the house, use when you don't clean up after yourself in the kitchen. I feel annoyed is the second portion. Finally, explain how their behavior impacts you, because it makes me work harder before cooking. Beginners should only send a three-part assertion message if it satisfies the following criteria. It's very likely to be effective, it won't violate the other person's space, it won't lower their self-esteem, and the other person won't respond defensively enough to harm the relationship. Beginners should also write down their assertions before saying them. When someone invades your space, you can confront them. Setting limits is not manipulative or domineering. Key idea number 5. Use the 6-step assertion method for defensive responses. Even if you respectfully state your assertion, the other person may be defensive. It's human nature. It's uncomfortable to hear you've hurt someone. Consider that defensiveness breeds defensiveness. That means you may unexpectedly feel hostile, but don't act on it. An allegation might quickly escalate into a defensive exchange. The assertor's wants are typically unsatisfied, and both people's self-esteem suffers. Effective assertion messages require more than simply delivery. It includes handling defensiveness. The author found that a 6-step assertion method works better than sending an assertion message. First, draft a brief, suitable, and non-blaming assertion message. Check if you've established trust. A pre-trust assertion message is more likely to demotivate. Choose scenarios where you'll succeed while starting assertion training. Next, try harder assertions. Step 2 is to communicate the message without small talk. Your body language should convey respect and sincerity. Stop after sending your brief. Polite assertion. Third, let the other person ponder what you said. Let them defend. Step 4. Contemplative listening. Respect reduces defensiveness. The other individual may have a strong need that conflicts with yours. If so, try collaborative problem solving, which we'll cover in the following blink. Step 5 is repeating the process. 3 to 10 cycles are needed before the other person understands and is willing to meet your needs. Assertion and reflection must be balanced. The author's hardest communication skill is role shifting. If the other person gets defensive and you strike back instead of listening, it becomes aggressive. If you stay in a listening role without asserting yourself, the interaction becomes passive. Finally, step 6 is to focus on the solution by making sure the other person's suggestion matches your demands and speaking up if it doesn't. Restate the solution if you're pleased, then schedule a checkup. Key idea number 6, center emotions and settle conflicts collaboratively. Even the best communicators encounter controversy. It's disruptive at best, destructive at worst. Conflict can also strengthen a relationship. Third, they choose the best answer for everyone. Everyone picks a solution and compares. Fourth, the group writes down who does what, when, and where. Then they execute. They then review the process and discuss the solution later. If the problem-solving strategy fails, they try again, avoiding barriers. How can you limit conflict damage? Before going in, there are two main categories of conflict, non-realistic and realistic. Non-realistic confrontation rarely works. Ignorance, tradition, prejudice, and wasteful competitiveness cause it. Thus, preventing a non-realistic conflict from escalating is your goal. Reduce barriers, practice introspective listening and assertiveness, and accept others. Realistic conflicts can be resolved productively. When two parties disagree, it occurs. Emotional, value, and need conflicts are realistic conflicts. Use the 3-step conflict resolution strategy for emotional or value conflicts. Respect others first. Listen until you can empathize by reflecting feelings, content, and significance. Finally, briefly describe your thoughts, needs, and feelings. Conflict resolution lets both parties express pent-up emotions, which normally dissipate rapidly. Even if they agree to disagree, one or both may change their ideas, strengthening their emotional tie. If you have conflicting needs, use collaborative problem solving. Collaborative problem solving needs listening, asserting, and conflict resolution abilities. Consider a home where everyone wants to utilize the car for distinct activities on the same day. After discovering their conflicting requirements, everyone can collaborate to find a solution. 6 steps. The group characterizes the problem as needs, not solutions. This time, everyone needs transportation, not the car. Second, everyone brainstorms new ideas, ignoring quality and focusing on quantity. Third, they choose the best answer for everyone. Everyone picks a solution and compares. Fourth, the group writes down who does what, when, and where. Then they execute. They then review the process and discuss the solution later. If the problem-solving strategy fails, they try again, avoiding barriers. Most of us abuse conversational obstacles, which hinders our social interactions. Avoiding barriers and practicing thoughtful listening and assertiveness can improve communication. Resolving greater interpersonal problems and collaborative problem solving require these complementary talents.
To view more content like this, subscribe. Don't forget to like and turn on notifications. The channel really benefits from it. I appreciate you being here.